rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay. Okay, are there any agenda changes for this evening?
No.
None? Okay. And now it's time for public comments. Do you have any public comments this evening? Seeing none, we'll move on. All right, we need to approve the consent agenda. So we've all had a chance to look over the consent agenda. We have a motion to approve the consent agenda. Motion by Mr. Grab.
Aye.
Second by Mr. Reynolds. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Oh, I'm sorry, that has to be a roll call. We'll start with Ms. Staub.
Aye.
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 Aye. Motion passes. Okay, on to the committee reports.
I had a grounds committee meeting on May 30th. Myself, Greg, Ray, Doug, Angie, and Vicki were here. Dennis was working, so he couldn't make it. We did a walkthrough. We walked most of the complex, spent a little over 3 hours, I think, in total. One of the things I was most surprised by was the condition of the northern part of the campus. We have water running in a couple of classrooms, like in the old basement area where the cafeteria used to be. The water's coming through the wall. It needs to be addressed right away. The locker rooms, both gyms, so the old gym and the new gym, are in really rough shape. Need updates and improvements. Found out that most of the kids aren't even using the showers. So that's kind of a big deal. We saw bricks on the east side of the building. The mortar cracked. And then, actually today, Greg and I were on the roof and we found another section down by the cafeteria that's cracked too. It looks like it's falling apart. So just some issues that may or may not be foundation issues, but definitely have some brick issues. There's two classrooms. Where the new addition on the south was attached to the old south addition. On the east side, we got water coming from the roof down through the wall and through the ceiling. We also had a room on the northeast side of the cafeteria where there's moisture coming through, possibly the wall through the wall vent. And I know you were here for some of it, Doug, but before we got completely done, and
right.
Some of this you don't know about.
Right.
We also talked about the asbestos in the old building and some of the cracked tile, and we need to figure out how to get that in the right shape before school starts. And then we toured the boiler room and tried to understand the future needs of that area and had some discussions about it. I would like to ask, as the chairman of the committee, that we give Greg taking the direction to call out an expert to evaluate the roofs and make the repairs as long as they don't exceed his decision authority amount in dollars. I would also like to give Greg the direction to call out an expert for the brick issues for the same thing, as long as they don't exceed the dollar decision authority that he has. And I was trying to think about that today, and I can't remember where I saw it, but I thought it was $20,000, but I don't know the number.
Okay.
I don't know if you found that yet or not, but we need to figure that out.
I believe it's 25.
What is it?
I think it's 25.
25 to bid.
To bid.
But there, what he's talking about is there a number that I'm allowed to spend without coming to you guys to ask?
Correct.
I thought it was 2,500 mark two.
2,500 or 25?
I think 25,000.
Yeah. It may be. I for some reason I had 20 in my head, but I couldn't
but
find
it. But it sounds like nobody's for sure, so I guess it needs to be.
We'll look at
that.
Find out.
Along with that, I'd also like to give a great direction to hire a contractor to dig along the walls of those two basement rooms or three, whatever it was down there, in the courtyard where the water's rushing in. He had water again in here last night. I think we get it dug down and look at it and then try to make a decision on what to do with it again, as long as it's within his decision authority. And he and I talked it today, and I can't imagine we can't crawl in a small piece of equipment and dig down to the bottom. It's probably about 4.5, 5 foot high. and try to determine exactly what's going on there, maybe put in a French drain or something and get that under control. Because that's, it's deteriorating the block, that's a block wall, that's not poured concrete, it's not gonna last long if it keeps pouring in like that.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but didn't we have a lot of that stuff done here 3, 4, 5 years ago?
And I was under the same impression, and so.
Something was done.
It was, when I talked to Bob, what happened was, we took out a bunch of landscaping timbers in that courtyard.
Okay.
And then we had it regraded, and then we had drains put in with all the downspouts, when they connected all that drainage.
Yeah, that reminds me, because, yeah, they even, took out some of this floor and the ramp and on that drain.
We replaced all that floor and the ramp, but we did not put a membrane on the exterior of the block wall, nor did we put a weakened tile in that would have caught any water, so. Yeah, I thought we had put something on the wall, but Don says we did not, or Bob says we did not.
There's actually a hole in one of the walls, and we gotta try to deal with it, so we're gonna lose those walls, where it goes down to, it's bad. They said it had up to 2 inches of water in that room.
Is that a situation where the life safety monies could, address that?
Yes. Yes.
I need, go ahead.
I was gonna say, are we saying to give, Greg, up to his decision authority and money per occurrence or total?
For each one.
Okay, I just wanted to clarify that. So if it's $20,000, up to, at this point, we've got roof, brick, and basement water, that would be $60,000.
Correct.
Okay.
And I don't think we even have to vote on it, I think we just give him the direction.
Well, there's nothing in there that says we're gonna vote, so we really can't vote.
Right, I understand, but I don't think we need to, because it's within the decision.
No, you give me a direction.
Just give the direction.
Well, and as far as the water drainage, that direction was to open it up and see what we got, to formulate a plan, a solution. And you talked about possible solutions, with concreting at all, or, and also looking for whether or not, if that drain tile that you put in, if it's clogged somewhere, or, that amount of water, it's hard to imagine that just that little 20 by 30 foot or whatever it is area getting rained on can accumulate that kind of water to get that flow, unless what's coming off of the roof and being directed into the drains, gutters, there's overflowing, is clogged, and then that water is being introduced into that same little area and it's not draining out. So that could be a source of the quantity of water.
I just wonder if that puts a verbiage in about the expert. So once we get enough, we get the right people in and we look at it, figure out what it takes and get it done. If it's a French drain, if we gotta pour concrete, we're gonna have to come back, because we're gonna have to do this, we'll never pour it for that.
Right.
Because they're gonna have to crane it over and put concrete in there, can't get there easily. Maybe power wheelbarrows or something, but you're gonna have to spend a lot more money to get that poured.
We also have that.
$600 for a bumper for 4 hours.
We also have that, old coal bin that's been condemned, that if we go in there and try to put anything permanent in, eventually that's gonna come out. Then we're gonna have to figure out, do we have to take care of it now, do we have to take care of it later? And this, really the only thing, and we talked about today, really the only thing that's in the way is there's an old shed, like a, you know, Sears and Roebuck shed, tin shed, that, you know, we could probably do without. That would have to be taken down so we can dig down along the foundation. The other option, I guess, too, we could call a foundation company and just get, you know, call a couple of them, talk to them first and say, hey, what do you think? And then, you know, depending on what they say, you know, we can kind of get a feel of, instead of going and doing the digging, I don't know. So I'm just throwing out.
I just want to give you direction, we can move forward and get something done.
Especially those classrooms.
And the summer is the time to do it.
Absolutely, before school gets started, we have to pitch 6 weeks, but 7 years before we start getting active. And then the other thing that Greg and I talked about was, doing a full-fledged study on the boiler / do we need a boiler, do we put in different technology versus a boiler, that we're gonna try to get with the architect and get some of that started.
Was that not part of the study that was already done?
The study before was, I want a boiler.
How much does it cost?
How much does it cost?
Okay.
How much? I'm saying since, after talking to Greg, what I believe is, the only thing that's on the boiler right now is the athletic director's office, which used to be one of the restrooms up in the east entrance to the gym. The gym itself and the locker rooms underneath.
Right.
And so with that being said, I don't know if that's right. That's why we need the experts to help us.
Okay.
Figure out what's the right solution. Maybe it's a mini boiler, maybe you put a DX unit on the roof and you put ductwork through the side. I don't know the answer. But that's how I think we should approach it versus telling them what we want and then trying to make it fit.
But inviting that expert in to our committee meeting.
Right.
So that we can kind of talk about, hey, what do you think? What do we need to do? This is kind of what we'd like to do, you know.
He and I were bouncing all kinds of ideas today, and you know, maybe that coal chute comes to platform and we put an air handler right there and that splits all the people. We don't know. But there's people out there that we'd be able to figure
right.
out really well.
So do we need a motion to direct or no motions at all?
No.
Okay.
I mean, unless somebody just said absolutely not, then we would have to arm wrestle.
True. Everybody feel okay about the giving Greg the direction?
Can't get me on that one.
Okay, let's go with that.
Okay.
Okay, running start committee.
We just concluded the meeting. We went over a couple of the points that the administrators and the counselors had. I think we're well on our way. Some things are already decided, just the participation, SWIC guides you through. We had some questions on participation in extracurricular, when students are going to be allowed on and off, and Greg's going to run with each of those. The further planning is for another hour meeting prior to the July board meeting, and then final verbiage with a contract would be, contract with our students would be formulated and be able to be seen, and then we could take action at the July meeting for our final participation levels.
Any questions on this? Let's move on to the student members report.
All right. So on May 21st, the class of 2017 held their commencement ceremony, which concluded the seniors' 4 years here. That was an exciting day for all of us. It was crazy just sitting there and thinking about that's what you worked for 4 years, and that was it. So. The rest of the school ended on May 24th, that Wednesday, and that wrapped up the end of the 2016-2017 school year. With the athletics, baseball wrapped up their season with their last game in the regional semifinal. Softball wrapped up their season in the regional championship. Girls soccer also wrapped up their season within the regional tournament. Several FCHS athletes competed at the IHSA state meet. The girls 4x8 team placed third. The girls 4x4 team also competed. Stephanie Jacobs placed 10th in the pole vault. And then Caroline Gagan competed in the triple jump, and she was a freshman, so it's pretty impressive. on the boys' side, the boys 4x4 placed 12th. Charlie Parrish placed 7th in the 3,200-meter run. Craig Collier placed 14th in the 800-meter run. I placed 4th in the 800-meter run. Brennan Mann competed in both the long and triple jump, and he was a part of the 4x4 team. And then Ian Alberts competed in the pole vault. And then performing arts-wise, band had their last performance of the year at our 2017 graduation ceremony.
Questions for Drew on his report? Congratulations to the state.
Thanks a lot, I appreciate
good,
it.
Good luck with college.
Thanks.
Excited.
I just wanted to say too that thanks a lot for the opportunity to be able to serve in this capacity. It was really cool to see how everything worked at this level, and it's something that I can take on with me for the rest of my life. So thank you very much, I appreciate it.
Okay. All right, principal's report.
I've got Jill's report. Jill was unable to make it because of a family commitment tonight, and Miss Kronk had a medical emergency with the family, so she was unable to make it as well. But Her report, summer has started, academics, the summer reading and math enrichment classes for incoming freshmen have been in full swing and will be finished this Friday. Mrs. Evers has been teaching the reading enrichment and Mr. Howes is taking care of the math. The summer gifted program for art is gearing up. The group will be attending workshops and programs at the Contemporary Art Museum, the St. Louis Public Library, the St. Louis Walking Architecture Tour, the Missouri Artists on Main, and the St. Louis Art Museum. Diplomas are ready and they can be picked up at Mrs. Meese's office. The Lou Cash Scholarship information can also be picked up at the same time. Ms. Jung and Ms. Crunk attended a 6-hour refresher course on the Danielson Teacher Evaluation Model last week at Muscoota High School. Our three new teachers have been in multiple times already, each spending a little bit of time. Bethany McQuiston, the new English teacher, spent a day with the English department. Megan Mitchell's been in a couple different times and has been at both Freeburg and Smithton, and we've met with her, and she's getting ready to start her summer camp and marching program. And Marissa Modlin is our ag teacher, and she spent last Monday with Mr. Range going through all the ag curriculum equipment and the FFA information. Each one of these teachers has been assigned a mentor, actually two mentors for next year. Ms. Modlin is going to have Karen Miller and Amanda Stewart. Bethany is going to have Natalie Westbecker and Ann Minor, and Megan Mitchell is going to have Michelle Etter and Matt Lauer. And so they are going to be working with those folks, and those folks will check in with the new teachers on a regular basis. The instructional coaches met for the first time. The instructional team, were announced at the last day of school. The coaches are already working on the ideas for their teams. Camps, basketball, football, and baseball have already had their grade school camps. Volleyball just finished today, I believe. Soccer, softball, cross country, and girls basketball camps are gearing up. Boys basketball had a scrimmage day at FCHS with teams from Altoff and Pinckneyville. Many teams have started summer training sessions, open gyms, weight training, and summer league play. If anybody's ever up here during the summer, it looks like school's going on. There's so many kids here. Cheerleading tryouts have finished for the fall cheer team, and the dance team practices have started. The office and custodial staff, these groups have been very busy closing out the 16-17 school year while beginning to prep for the fall. The office work and classroom locker cleaning is in high gear. Fall registration dates will be announced in the upcoming weeks. I know Ms. Jung is pretty excited about some changes for the registration. And so those will be announced. I believe she's gonna put them in the paper next week and send out an email, but we're hoping that what she's doing is gonna make things a lot easier. And so that's all she has.
Does anybody have any questions for Ms. Jung? No? Okay, let's move on to the superintendent's report.
Okay, so legislative update. I included, I just got this today. It looks like I printed it out at 5:19 today. This Governor Rauner has called a special session of the Illinois General Assembly to meet next Wednesday. They are trying to put together a state budget. I will tell you that both the House and the Senate passed a education funding bill and included a lot of different things. I'm not going to read through all this, but it does include a little bit more money. It's also has an evidence-based funding model, which I put in my writing, is going to look very good for Freeburg for the first 2 years. After that, we'll see how it goes. I'm concerned that there could be a substantial loss in state aid. But this also includes some information about pensions. There's some information there about school consolidation. There's also workman's compensation, and then a call for a constitutional amendment for legislative term limits. So obviously this will pass with no problem. I wrote up in here that I was, I talked with Larry Dirks. This next one's about the board self-evaluation, and I have two dates tentatively saved by him. August 7th, Monday, August 7th, and Thursday, August 10th. This is that self-evaluation where we can meet with him in closed session, where it's the board, myself, and Larry Dirks, who's from the School Board Association. And they kind of run through a little program where he tries to get everybody working together on the same page and having the same ideas of how school boards should work. This is something that schools do on a regular basis, so maybe before you leave tonight, let Jane know which day works better for you. I don't need to spend a whole lot of time on it, but.
Are these evening?
They're evening, 7 o'clock.
Okay.
It would start at 7, and he says about 3 hours.
It's a Monday and a Thursday.
Yeah, and so depending on what we do, then Doug and I would communicate with Larry on which type of evaluation we want to do. So there's a couple different ways we can go about this. So we would kind of talk about it and go from there. So if you would like, kind of check your calendars, if you haven't already, and see which day works best. And if one of those don't work, then we'll try to work out another date. But August was the earliest we could get it.
You want those just emailed in, or do you want to know that?
If you can let her, if you, before tonight, if you let Jane know, that would be the best. Summer work has begun. You'll hear a little bit more in closed session about some movement in our janitorial staff, but they've been going through, like they do every year, cleaning the classrooms. Through some of the work and that we did in the building and grounds, I found the 10-year health, life, safety, and I pulled one of the janitors off the cleaning duties and assigned him to work through the health, life, safety violations. There's about, I don't know, 47 or so. And so we prioritized the A priorities and then the B's, then the C's. And so he's basically worked through almost everything he can in the A's and the B's. And so we're to the point where we're starting to order parts and supplies to upgrade those things. There are some things that he's not gonna be able to do that we'll have to hire in somebody from the outside to complete it, but I'm happy with the work that he's doing and the work that's going on at school, so we'll keep going on that. And then if you're on the hard copy, these are added on here. We just got notification of the III conference. This is something that I'm really interested in finding if we can get as many board members to go on the conference. This is in November. It's the weekend before Thanksgiving. I would like to see if all the board members can attend, and I would also like to have Ms. Jung and Ms. Schaefer attend. There is quite a few things for principals, and there's also quite a few things for the bookkeepers to get out of this. So there are all three of those organizations, the school board, the administrative organization, and the school bookkeepers organization, business managers organization, or whatever it's called. So I think it would be beneficial for all three to go. The district, the only thing the district pays for spouses is the room, and it doesn't cost any extra for the spouse to be in the room. Everybody usually gets their own room, and then the spouses would be responsible for their own costs. We pay for reimbursed up to a certain amount for the school board members. So this is something I think really important. So I would like for you guys to check your calendars. I have in your packets, there is a printout of, I think, yeah, basically we have to know who's going to attend, and we have to pay the registration fee and put a deposit on the hotel. I will tell you, the hotels go quickly. We prefer to have a hotel that's in the conference, so there's two places. There's the Sheraton up there. Then it's either the Swiss Hotel or the one next door, the Hyatt, where the other one is. So if we get those, it makes it a lot easier to go to the conferences and not have to walk outside. But if you would let Jane know, and then the dates are November 17th through the 19th. And typically what we've done in the past is we go up sometime Thursday. There are a lot of sessions Friday morning that it's outside of the conference, so it would be an additional cost, but we've got negotiations coming up, we've got new school board members, there's all kinds of things once we get the booklet that it would be worth our while to go up Thursday, go to attend some of these things, and especially you know, to depending on who's, if we already know who's gonna negotiate, have those people attend, possibly some negotiating sessions, but I think it's worthwhile. So I would like, if you could let Jane know by July 1st, that we will start making reservations for that. So I don't know if anybody has any questions on that or not. And then last thing I have is Mr. Wilkerson. I have a little plaque here for you that I would like to give to you on behalf of myself and the board. And if I can read through this, student member of the Board of Education, 2016-17, I'm gonna pull it out. Says, in appreciation, dedicated service to the student, staff, communities of Freeburg Community High School District 77. Thank you so much for your work. Congratulations. Yelled at the cafeteria.
Does anybody have any questions on the superintendent's report? Comments? Okay, seeing none, let's move on to old business, A, reorganization study.
This was something that somebody had asked to be put on the agenda. This is something that we talked about last year and put off. I have spoken with all three of the other districts, and I will tell you that several of them are going to also have this on their agenda this month. I did not want to tell you what I think they're going to do, but I don't think all of them are interested, but I think some are. So I think they are very much interested in doing the study, sharing the cost, and contacting the IASA to begin the study. So I don't know that we need, I mean, we can agree to participate in the study, but we don't know what the cost is going to be yet. You know, so we could make a motion to agree to the study, and then, you know, up to a certain dollar value. But if three districts do it and it costs us $15,000, I think it's somewhere between $12,000, $15,000, maybe $5,000. So that way I can actually get it in the budget and put a line item in there on the consolidation study. But, or we can wait until July, because the study would not begin until probably January at the latest, December or January. So we have several months. So we could have this conversation with the other, allow me to have conversations with the other superintendents, see where they're at, then we can really talk about the details of it.
Be nice to know what the other school districts want to do.
That, and are we going to go after the state money that they allow for that study?
That was available last year. If it's available,
so I'm not sure if it will be
yes.
There.
But if it's not, then it would probably have to come out of our budgets. Yeah.
And that came available in September of last year, just for that. And in October is when we looked at it and decided this year. The only comments that I have on it, my memory was closer to an $11,000 figure by Dr. Phillips for participation. So it could be a little bit lower than these figures. And then with Dr. Holmes moving on to a different position, it's going to leave Smithton in an interesting position. They're trying to get a superintendent to come in there along with the consolidation study that may or may not be that show that it's beneficial, but at least an answer would be for once and for all, we'd have some good information instead of speculation. And then I didn't know that it could be done as quickly as 4 months. I don't know, I'd mentioned to Greg also, and he does not think they would be interested, but it certainly wouldn't hurt to offer an invitation to New Athens to see if they would want to be a participant in a study. You got another community 8 miles south of Freeburg that this school certainly could handle. handle the students in a high school. And I don't know, it'd either be their community or their school, but an invitation to participate could be looked at.
How do you figure we can handle the weight of the students?
With the numbers?
Yes.
Have we had 800 students before?
No.
Never?
We had 750.
Correctly, and the building's capacity is what, 6-something?
I don't know that. I don't know off the top of my head what the capacity is.
I heard the number was...
But I will tell you, we don't have any empty classrooms.
No.
So there's not a place...
Any room to bring in another district.
When we had 750, we had, I would say, 3 or 4 teachers that were floaters. So they lived off a cart, pushed the cart from classroom to classroom, so teachers shared the classroom, so...
So in fact, we may be limited by just the facilities to what we have now.
Yes.
I thought perhaps with the running start program as a safety valve or...
Running start DP panel pushing out the door.
Yeah, I mean, that's, it would be something that would have to be looked at.
Put a few hundred out the door.
If not, just the three districts, 70 and Smith would be a great start.
I think that's where it should stay, right there, yeah.
Okay.
So what are our feelings about for tonight? Do we want to wait until July and let the other school boards discuss it, like Greg talked to the other superintendents, or do we want to allow us, we'd like to be in it up to a certain number, up to $6,000 or something like that? What do we want to do tonight?
I'd say let's let the other schools make their decision and
see where they're standing.
From there, yeah.
Okay.
I would agree.
Angie? Okay.
Yeah, I think finding out where they stand, because for us to do a study all by ourselves and nobody wants to do it, that's just us throwing our money out the door.
Right.
No, and I would agree. I think actually that we should take decisive action for participation on a cost-shared basis with the other schools. But I've always felt that the high school, since we're the other schools feed us, that we should take a leadership position in pushing for this study. So I would be in favor of us moving that we participate on a cost share basis, equal share basis with the others. So they know we want to do it. We're not waiting to see if you want to do it or not. We want to do it, but our participation is contingent on each of the other districts paying their fair share.
Right. We'll make that in the form of a motion.
Well, I will at the end.
Let's wait and see what discussion.
I was going to ask you, Greg, going to that meeting that happened over at Smithman, so I'm assuming Dr. Holmes was interested in that. You said some people were, some people weren't. Us, Tommy Diefenbach, not so much.
Did I just say I wasn't going to put my cards on the table? I think 3 of the 4 districts are going to be interested in doing the study. And I think we'll know within a week. And there's no rush, and I don't think the other districts really care if we say yes or no. I mean, Smithton said yes last year without us.
Yeah.
And I think we have plenty of time. So, but it doesn't, I mean, if we want to make a motion and say we're willing to do it, then I think we're going to be in the same position in a couple months, no matter what we do tonight.
I'm kind of where Dennis is on this. I think we just need to go ahead and commit to it and share the cost with the other districts. And I don't know if we have to take the lead because we're the high school, but I think from the timing of our meeting, we've got meetings a little earlier than other folks this morning. So I think we should go ahead and do it. And then, like Greg said, even though we're going to go ahead and, if we go ahead and approve it, doesn't mean it's going to be active right away anyway. It's going to take a little while for our schools to get their votes in and get to be a part of it, and then they start collecting data. I don't think there's anything bad that can come out of it, even if there's no consolidation for anybody. I mean, they should look at bus routes and just all kinds of things that could help us save money maybe in the long run. So I think it's a good thing.
Ditto. I hear that too. We need to divide the cost though.
And we may get a surprise that September the state comes up with the $8,000 again, and so then our.
What you could do is make a motion to pursue a consolidation study with the other districts and kind of make it formal that you're directing me to make contact with those districts and we'll try to move forward. That way we don't have to talk about money until we see what the other districts are doing. But you come out with a statement saying that we are wanting to do this, which I think is what you guys want.
Right.
So too. Do we have a motion?
Very well, then I'll make a motion that we direct Greg to contact the other districts that our desire is to pursue a consolidation study this next year with Freeburg and Smithton. We can invite St. Laborie, but I doubt if they'll participate, but we'll see.
I didn't say a word.
I know. And there's provisions in the consolidation program for a hybrid district that they can remain as they are and still send their kids here. So.
Okay.
I'll second that.
That was Ms. Haas and Ms. Reynolds. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
Motion passes. Okay. No participation in athletics.
This was another one that was brought up by somebody that would like to have the discussion. So for years, Freeburg High School has not allowed students to participate in more than one sport during a season. And so I will tell you that our AD kind of canvassed the other conference schools, and the only school that does not allow it is Columbia. The others do allow it. But from the information, and I kind of wrote about this, from the information from all these districts is there is some fairly concrete rules on how this works. As far as students have to pick a primary sport, and if there's conflicts, they have to go with that primary sport. Doesn't matter what the activity is. It doesn't matter if, you know, if they pick, let's say, for instance, in the fall, they pick soccer and football happens to be going to playoff, and they're in soccer, and it's the same day. If they pick soccer, they're going with soccer. They can't change their mind after they've picked. And you get into a little more details as far as practice versus games. But I also think that it would be beneficial for us to have a kind of a concrete set of rules written down before the board agrees to just do it. Now, again, kind of like the last one, if the board is interested, if they would like to say they are interested in doing this, it would then direct the superintendent and AD and principal to sit down and work through the details so that this could be brought up in July. The only way it would happen for this year is if it was approved at the latest at the July meeting. Otherwise, if you're not interested in it happening until next year, then we've got time. But I would caution us not to move forward with this until we kind of have some concrete rules written down.
You know, another thing that comes to mind real quickly is because people tend to support what they help to create, wouldn't we want to do a poll of all of our coaches, some of them long-standing people, to see what their philosophy is on that? Involve that in the discussion or bring that forward at some point in time?
We can, but I guess my question is that going to change some of the board members' minds?
Maybe not. But
so, I mean, we can. And we can bring that information along with whatever you guys decide direction you want to go.
Well, we've got an athletic director. We've got some people that have been longstanding in some of those roles and functions. And I think their opinions ought to weigh in about how this might fit on a balance scale.
Mr. Lauer was talking to some of the other schools about what kind of numbers were they talking?
Very, very small. Some schools, they haven't had anybody do it. Some schools, one kid does it. You know, they may have the outstanding student that comes in and it's just, you know, they love softball, but they may be able to get a track scholarship. So, you know, maybe they still like to play softball, but their main thing is track. So I think that's happened a little, but it's not, according to them, it doesn't happen very often. Maybe one or two.
There's some obvious ones. The most common is the place kicker on a football team being a soccer player. And I could also see, for instance, we have arguably a state contender in our cross country program that is missing a few people that perhaps some on the soccer team might be available. When Matt reached out to those other ADs, and what Greg was alluding to is it is cut and dry on participation, or the top of which both coaches of the sports have to agree to it. So if either coach does not agree, then it's not the student's decision. Both coaches have to agree on participation to abide by the rules set forth. A primary sport is designated, a secondary sport is designated. If there's a game in the game, you go to the primary sport. If there's a practice in a practice, you go to the primary practice. If there's a game in a practice, then you're allowed to go to the other game. So those kind of conflicts are taken out of the student's hands. And also the situation where if a student would quit one of the sports, he's also out of the other sport. So you can't, a student cannot quit his primary designation mid-season and then decide that he wants to, I've got a better chance to go with his secondary. And that's all on input from the other ADs. The reasons for it. One, we're the smallest fish in our conference as far as being 600. Is 600 not the cutoff for?
We're the third biggest.
For our class.
You're talking, class. Not conference, class.
Not conference, class. For our class.
The class goes from about 580 to about 1200.
Okay.
And we're about 650, so we're in the lower portion.
Okay, I thought we had fewer students than that.
Yeah,
but regardless, the multiple sport athletes, the more of them that we can play, I think helps our competitive position in there. And who's to say that a kid that loves soccer, for instance, can't get out there and do well as a extra point or a kicker and be recognized through a scholarship opportunity or something for being able to kick the football. Other schools do it. I don't see any reason that we should afford that student the same opportunity.
I can see you opening a big can of worms for this. Frankly, I think you're going to have a lot of disgruntled parents, coaches, and athletes if they see kids being able to bounce around and probably coming in and taking their place during a game. And I'm just flat out not for it. It sounds like you've already went through all kind of questions on what you need to do to govern it. I think just leave it alone, don't mess with it, and I think it'll be a lot easier to manage in the long run if you just leave it as is.
With the governing of it, how do you decide which practice you go to? Is that coordinated with the coaches? Because most practices are after school.
It all depends on how it's set up.
How do other schools do it? Do they like be a practice on Monday for soccer, practice on Tuesday for football, and bounce?
They could set it up like that, or it could be set up where if your practices are the same, you go to your primary sport.
So you never go to practice for your secondary?
Could possibly be, yes. Yeah.
Drew, what are your thoughts?
Oh, boy.
As an athlete that excelled.
You know, I think, I've seen a lot of good athletes that could handle it, but I think it would be for the special athlete, like the one or two
right. That
come out and can be a natural track athlete and then go play soccer or something. Like, I mean, I think the example that comes to mind for me is Brianna Chandler, I think, because she's wavering between track and soccer. But I think someone like a Brianna Chandler could take it, but I don't necessarily think that any average athlete. It's just one of those things where it's like someone could be overloaded easily with that responsibility. Because playing two sports, I mean, playing one sport is enough of a responsibility. Two sports on top of like grades and other extracurriculars, I think would be a handful. But I think it would be should be on a case by case basis.
Well, that's why I was asking about the numbers. I don't think you're going to have. You were talking about the exceptional athlete. I don't think the average athlete is going to say, I want to play football and run cross country because I'm not even starting with football.
I don't know about that. I think you're going to find that the average kid is going to want to do both very well. I don't know how you can sit there and say that the average one isn't going to ask for that.
Well, I think there's enough, might be, I might be wrong, but I think there might be enough interest here to look into it, to maybe just have Mr. Lauer and talk to the other schools more and get more information about it. If they're only having one or two, I don't necessarily think that, I mean, that's not the worry that I feel like I hear from you. If it was 10 or 20 trying to do it.
I don't even think it should be one.
There was an instance, I had talked with the track coach, because there were some kids that I knew were decent runners in grade school, and I was like, man, why isn't this kid, why did he do baseball? He didn't even do baseball in grade school. Well, the story was that nobody signed up as freshman, so he thought he'd get to play. Well, he signed up, then a bunch of other kids signed up, and he was fast. So the coach, hey, you're my outfield defensive guy, you're my pinch runner for 2 years. And junior year, the track coach is like, are you sure? You know, you can see the writing on the wall. You can see there's a good freshman that's going to play a lot. There's sophomores that are going to start ahead of you. You're not going to have a starting spot. Nope, gonna do it. Well, the track coach felt the baseball coach did him a disservice, because about after 3 weeks of practice, and he couldn't practice track, he said, you know what, I don't even have a spot for you, even pinch running. So if that kid could have been hedging his bets, because he probably would have been a participant in maybe one of the state relays, he might have had a decent shot to actually have a fulfilling junior year rather than
Well, the way I look at it, if I understood you right, he's only participated in baseball for 2 years.
This is his third year. He was participating his third year.
There's nothing to say he can't participate in his senior year. And anyway, that's
he probably will. He probably will.
I mean,
but if he had that opportunity,
make those decisions on what sport you want to play and stick with it.
But he had made the comments to the coach, I wish we could have done this to where I could have been able to continue to run. And I don't know how much you know about track, but if you don't run for 3 years and then all of a sudden jump in your senior year, you're probably not going to be the athlete that you could have been if you'd been training and racing. You don't just, I can't get off the couch and run, you know, if I haven't done it for 2 or 3 years. So, I don't know. What are your guys' feelings?
I think we need a concrete set of rules moving forward, but I'd like to see those, see what Mr. Lauer, his opinion is on other coaches, and have him talk to other schools and see how it works.
Mm-hmm.
And then
yeah, I'm okay. I would probably just do this in direction to go meet with Matt, come up with the best thing they got, and then we'll look at it and see if it's a yay or a nay. And then we've concluded our study.
Back to the new people support with the upgrading. The people are going to have a hand in it. Probably.
So I don't think we need a motion at this time. I think we just give Greg direction.
And do we want to have a separate meeting for discussion then? Or are we just going to bring this back next board meeting.
Just table it till next board meeting, I'd be in favor of, and Greg can do a little bit more research on it.
That'll be okay.
So do we want him coming back with a set of rules already, or are we?
Maybe he comes back with a proposal. If we're gonna do it, this is the way that the AD and the coach.
I would actually.
Coaches decided it would be.
I would feel more comfortable if the board voted on looking into dual participation, as opposed to.
Direction.
Well, I just feel like if you, I think you guys need to say, hey, we're interested and we wanna see a concrete set of rules, as opposed to, you know, go ahead and go back and work something out. I just think it just makes it a little bit cleaner.
Do we have a motion?
Well, I'll make a motion that we direct Greg to look into the feasibility of dual participation in athletics for our students during the season. And to Corey from Matt and from the other schools within our conference on how they manage their program of best practices, so that we can tailor our program accordingly, or at least make an educated decision whether or not it would be just too difficult to manage, and we should stay where we are, okay, this would be an acceptable basis to allow participation.
So we pretty much have all that. So we have information from the schools on how they organize it. You know, the idea of trying to see if it's feasible, I mean, it's feasible. It can be done. So.
I was giving you an out.
Well, but that's, I'm trying to not give you an out, is what I'm trying to do really. Is I want the board to publicly say that they are interested and they would like me to work on a set of rules to, you know, allow dual participation.
I'm trying to tailor the motion to come up with a set of rules that would allow our participation, but at the same time not making that vote for participation at this time. That's my desire.
Don't we want it, like Ray had said, don't we want to hear what the rest of the coaches feel about it?
I mean, that's out there. I've seen it also, but we should share it.
Right, but so, I mean, I need to have, I need to show up to the July meeting with a set of rules that you're going to vote on. Otherwise, it won't happen this year. So unless I come in with, these are the rules, these are our proposed rules for dual participation, if we're not going to be able to do it this year because July's it. We don't have another meeting after July. You follow me? So I can do what I think Ray's talking about, and I can work with everybody to find out what their thoughts are, but I think it would be beneficial if it was, the board has decided that they want to do this, please come up with a set of rules so they can formally vote.
Then I'd make a motion that you come up with a framework and a set of rules that would allow our participation for dual participation of a student in athletics, so that we can look at it and in the July meeting decide whether or not we wanted to go forward or just remain as we are.
Can I ask one more question?
Sure.
You weren't born yesterday. You've coached here. You know about these people. If your finger is on the pulse of that, what do you think? How do you think that'll be received?
I think with the number of newer coaches, that it's going to be received a lot better than it would have 10 years ago.
From the old times. So it's maybe a...
Probably myself included.
Like a coin flip on this thing.
It's probably leaning more towards what I think the consensus of the board is.
That answers my question.
I
is that enough of a motion?